So let's then talk a little bit about just generally how we treat our patients with metastatic neuroendocrine tumors. I'm going to take a little step back. We were just talking about chemotherapy, and we'll talk about targeted agents. But in fact, for neuroendocrine tumors that are metastatic, there are other options, and some of those options include liver-directed therapies. Rod, you're an expert in this area. What are some of the options that we have for liver-directed therapies, and also what patients are the right patients to take that approach in?
I think that's a very important issue, Matt. Very often when physicians are looking at the initial scans on a patient with a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor and see generally numerous bilobar metastases, they're wearing a different type of a hat than a neuroendocrine tumor oncologist hat. They're thinking in terms of hepatocellular carcinoma and colorectal metastases, in which there are very strict rules for operating on the liver. In other words, you have to be able to do some type of a liver resection, like a right hepatectomy or a left hepatectomy, in which you will get all the disease out and you will get negative margins and there's nothing left in the remnant and you can't have any extra hepatic disease. And in fact, the rules for neuroendocrine tumors aren't that strict. Traditionally, it's been said that if we can debulk the liver and get 90% of the disease out, we can get very, very good long-term survival rates and results. We also do not need negative margins, whereas colorectal metastases have this infiltrative pattern and tentacles coming out from the tumor that require us to get wide margins, because if we don't, it recurs at that margin and the operation is considered futile. Neuroendocrine tumors land in the liver and they're pushers, and you can actually enucleate them, and the patterns of recurrence from enucleation are no worse than we get with wide resection with negative margins. So I think it's important to really get someone experienced to look at the scans and see if there's a potential debulking surgery that can be done. Well, currently we're publishing a series right now where we actually used even less stringent criteria of a 70% debulking, and we found that we had 5 and 6 year survival rates in the 90% with that less stringent criterion. Then you can go on to for patients who chiefly will have liver dominant disease, we can do arterial directed therapies. One special thing about the liver is it's the only organ in the body that has two separate blood supplies. It's got the portal vein by which these metastases arrived, and then the hepatic arterial tree coming off of the aorta. And once the tumor lands in the liver, it has to get a blood supply going, and it derives that chiefly from the hepatic artery. Virtually none of it comes from the portal system. So by putting either embolic material, or in some cases people prefer chemoembolic material, or even now, in the last few years, we've been using radioembolization, of using microspheres that carry yttrium-90, for example. That can be directed through the arterial tree to the tumors, impacting them and leaving the normal hepatic parenchyma essentially unaffected. So, you know, we need to think before we leap, before we decide to embolize, which can literally create a bridge that, you know, is burned that we can't go back. Someone may be a very good candidate for a liver debulking, but if they get embolized first, that may preclude a successful liver operation. So we want to plan and make sure that we get these things right. But we would use the embolic treatments for patients who have too extensive of disease to be treated with a surgical debulking. And sometimes when it looks like a patient really couldn't afford much more progression, that we can't really watch them because that might be very detrimental to their survival, then I think we have to think real hard about should they have chemotherapy or maybe an embolic treatment right up front.